Good afternoon, friends. So welcome to GATE classes. It is the second week for Prerana GATE 2020-2021 actually. So all students can join. Last week only general English classes are conducted, but this week only engineering classes today and Monday, not in Sunday tomorrow. I will send the link tomorrow for Monday class. So then next week onwards only Saturday, Sundays, Saturday 2 hours and Sunday 2 hours, both general engineering, maths, aptitude, etc. Then along with engineering subjects. So within a given classes, so maybe for total of 40 classes are there, that's all. So engineering 40 classes and general English 40 classes. So it's very difficult to cover all engineering subjects because of many engineering subjects are there in civil engineering also, right from surveying to pre-stressure concrete. So of course within the classes you will discuss the main theory part. If possible then you can do the GATE problems also, but anyhow I can send the problems already solved, then you can practice it. But I think it is also helpful to you, especially students who are in final year now, after a long gap, maybe 6 months, even WRE one subject also you are already studied in 3-2, but to attempt university examinations, it is somewhat easy to you to attempt university examination also along with the GATE examination. So please concentrate on that, utilize the time. So let's see, the straight away we'll go to hydrologic cycle. So you know the, what is hydrology, already studied in 3-2. So presentation visible, huh? Please Yojita.
Yes sir.
Presentation visible, huh?
Right.
So, first of all, so this hydrology, irrigation, then fluid mechanics. So all together under water resource engineering actually. So I'm supposed to deal with the water resource engineering in hydrology, irrigation, then followed by irrigation structures. So now, what is meant by hydrology? Hydrology is a science of water, which deals with the occurrence, circulation, and distribution of water of the earth and Earth's atmosphere. So when coming to hydrological cycle, so you know the cycle in the form of the three important phases in cycle is evaporation, then precipitation, runoff. So water in the oceans evaporate due to the heat energy provided by solar radiation, solar rotation. So the water vapor moves upward and forms clouds, so while much of the clouds condenses and fill back to the oceans as a rain. So there is a concept of formation of rain. So as part of the clouds is driven to the land areas by winds. So there they condense and precipitate onto the landmass as rain, snow, hail, sleet, etc. There is the forms of precipitation, you know, the forms of precipitation is rain, snow, hail, sleet, glaze, etc. So the precipitation reaching the ground surface. So after meeting the needs of infiltration, because of some loss are there, you know that infiltration is one of the loss and before runoff. So needs of infiltration and evaporation moves down the natural slope over the surface as a runoff, it's called as runoff, and through a network of gullies, streams and rivers to reach the finally, it will reach the ocean. So this cycle repeats and it's called a hydrological cycle. So now coming to the transpiration components. So precipitation, evaporation, transpiration, infiltration, then runoff. So this is the transportation components, right? So precipitation means in the form of rain. Evaporation means evaporation, you know, the natural process of evaporation. Transpiration, so evaporation from the plants. Then infiltration, right? Infiltrates into the ground. So runoff, then surface runoff means water is moving, water is run through the surface. This is all transportation components. Now coming to the storage components, storage and the land surface, sometimes the runoff water may be stored. So storage on the land surface, soil moisture storage, groundwater storage. So precipitation, all forms of water that reaches the earth from the atmosphere. So this is the important question. Let us say isopluvial lines. So sometimes it may stress lines connecting equal depth of rainfall of some period. So isopluvial lines are the lines connecting the equal depth of rainfall. Say there are two or three items are there: equal depth of rainfall, equal intensity of rainfall, right? So this you have to remember. So now first point, equal depth of rainfall. Just write down for some important points, because it is easy to get one mark. So the lines connecting equal depth of rainfall is called isopluvial lines. So now they are coming to the forms of precipitation. So that part is over head wall cycle. That is, we don't need to discuss much on that actually. This is a natural cycle. So water is evaporated from the sea, then formation of clouds, condense, and then precipitation in form of rain. So after meeting the losses like evaporation and infiltration, etc., that it will run on the surface. That's called surface runoff. So then finally it will reach to the ocean. That is the concept of hydrological cycle. Now, let's come to the forms of precipitation. So one is rain. So so drop size larger than a 0.5 mm, maximum size 6 mm. So the when it called as a rain actually, so the water droplet size is larger than 0.5 mm and it's a maximum of 6 mm. So when it's called light rain, when it's called moderate rain, when it's called heavy rain. So we discussed it many times. So light rains, so moderate, heavy rains, there may be chance of heavy rains tomorrow like that. So let's say what is meant by light rain means the intensity is less than 2.5 millimeter per hour, it may call as light rains. So 2.5 millimeter per hour, right? Per hour, so there is a rainfall and rainfall intensity. Rainfall means only depth. Rainfall intensity means it gives direction also, that, the vector quantity. So intensity means 2.5 millimeter per hour, it's called light rates. So when it's called as a moderate rain is 2.5 millimeter per hour to 7.5 millimeter per hour. When it calls heavy rain means it's greater than 7.5 millimeter per hour, is called as a heavy rain. So these three, remember that. Then snow, drizzle, glaze, sleet, hail. Of course, the Indian conditions may not appear in the snow. It may not applicable for Indian conditions. Drizzle is it's there. So today is drizzling. Today it's drizzling. So when it is drizzling, droplet size less than 0.5 mm, and also intensity is less than 1 meter per hour, is called drizzle. When it's called glaze, the water drops freeze to form an ice coating. Of course, the Indian conditions may not. Applicable, then hail. It's a irregular pellets or lumps of ice of size more than 8 mm. This is a thunderstorms. This is called hail. So now you know how to measure the rainfall. Already studied in your rainfall measurement of rainfall actually. So measurement of rainfall may automatic rain gauges or non-automatic rain gauges, whatever it is. After that, then missing data you have to find out. That is important in gate examination point of view also. So you see density of rain gauge. So 10% of rain gauge station should be equipped with self-recording tape rain gauges to know the intensity of rainfall. So this what is called as automatic recording rain gauges. So that recording gauge automatically gives intensity of rainfall, not rainfall. But in case of non-recording gauges, only depth, rainfall depth may be given. That's the difference between the non-recording and recording. So from practical considerations of Indian conditions, the Indian standard code is this one actually, the IS code of rainfall measurement 4987-1968, recommendations the following densities as sufficient. So Indian Meteorological Department also designed that some extent of area, they are supposed to recommend the number of rain gauges like this. So in plain regions, 5200 square kilometers, one rain gauge. So because of the elevations between 1000 meters and 262-300 square kilometers, one rain gauge station like that. In mountains, areas, hilly areas, heavy rainfall, one gauge station recommended for every 130 square kilometers. So in mountains are very heavy rainfall, so one rain gauge station is recommended for every 100 square kilometers. Now it is rain gauge network means optimum number of rain gauge stations, because of why it is such actually optimum number of rain gauge stations means how many rain gauges required. For example, Tirupati city. So Tirupati city expanding, let us say for example 20 square kilometers. Let's say, for example, 20 square kilometers Tirupati area expanded to 20 square kilometers. Now, how many rain gauges required for recording rain gauge? So sometimes you may observe Kapil Tirtham, there may be a rainfall of 2 centimeters, but outskirts, city outskirts, maybe Tiruchirappalli, there is no rainfall. So that's why how many rain gauges required for a given area actually? Now this is the calculation part. N equal optimum number of rain gauge station. N equal to CV by epsilon whole square. Then one over CV equal to coefficient of variation, right? That's called standard deviation by mean, sigma by p bar. That I already have the class also discussed itself. Sigma by p bar. So sigma by p bar into 100. This is called coefficient of variation. Then what is standard deviation actually? So then epsilon equal to allowable degree of error in the estimation of mean rainfall. Sigma m minus 1, that's called standard deviation, equal to sigma I equal to 1 to m, pi minus p bar whole square by m minus 1. That's m equal to number of rain gauge stations. Right? So pi means rain gauge number 1, number 2, number 3, like this. P1, P2, P3, P4, like that. P bar means mean rainfall. Because of, well, let us say, for example, number of stations 1, 2, 3, 4. Rainfall may be x1, x2, x3, x4. That's average rainfall depth, x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4, x4. It will give average rainfall. Now, how to estimation of missing data? So, let us say two methods. One is simple average method, second one is weighted average method. One simple average method, we see Px means precipitation at station x. So, because of, you know, the station x is missing data like that. Perhaps if a number of stations are there, precipitation at station x is missing due to any reason. So, the formula for precipitation at any station x, Px equal to 1 by m, m equal to number of stations, into P1 plus P2 plus and so on Pm, because simple average. So this method is applicable if the normal annual precipitation at various stations are within the about 10% of the normal annual precipitation at station x. Let's, for example, if you compare the rainfall values, right? Normal annual, because again you may have a doubt. Normal rainfall means 30 years average. What is the rainfall? What is the normal rainfall? What is the average rainfall? What is effective rainfall? These words we are supposed to know very well. So normal rainfall, it is recorded one. So 30 years of average to be taken as a normal rainfall, because of the set of 30 years data. For example, Tirupati city normal annual rainfall, how much? Maybe 1100 mm to 1200 mm. How it is actually calculated, how it's obtained from last 30 years data. So let's say for 1970 to 2000, 30 years data, you're supposed to take average, then it may be considered as a annual precipitation of Tirupati rainfall, like that. So suppose, for example, Tirupati, Chandragiri, Srinagar, all like that, there are four rain gauge stations. One station is missing. One station missing means the rainfall data is missing. How can you find out that missing data? So now the missing data means, let's say for X. So this X is compared with the other stations. So that comparison within the 10% of normal annual precipitation, this formula is used, direct formula. Now, coming to the weighted average, difference greater than 10%, then you may go for the weighted average method. So, how it is actually Px equal to Nx by m into P1 by n1 plus P2 by n2 plus and so on Pm by nm. What is this actually? P1, P2 likes average rainfall values. N1, N2 means normal annual precipitation at station 1, station 2, station 3, like that. Let's say I told that Tirupati, Srinagar, something like that. Nx means normal precipitation at station X, because of the station which rainfall data is missing, that may be called as station X. By M is number of rain gauge, 1, 2, 3, like this. Here 3, 3, 4, 4, there. So this must be applicable if the normal annual precipitation at various stations are not lies within the 10% of normal annual precipitation at station X, where Ni equal to, see, let's say this one, normal annual precipitation, Pi equal to annual precipitation. So this is very, very important actually. Every GATE examination, one problem given from this one, missing data, the precipitation at station X, how to calculate. Then how to present rainfall data, because you may have the rainfall data. So on how many ways to present the rainfall data? For example, Tirupati recorded 2 centimeters today, but how many ways to record that actually? Straight away you may told today Tirupati received two centimeters, like that. But if you go for analysis, the 2 centimeters will be occurred in 1 hour, 2 centimeters of rainfall occurred in 24 hours or 10 minutes, like that. So there's how many ways to present rainfall data means, option A, mass curve of rainfall, actually it is a plot of accumulated precipitation against time. Let's say, for example, today rain is started at 9 a.m. up to this rain is continuing. So mass curve of rainfall means accumulated precipitation against time. Let's say 10 o'clock, 2 centimeters, 11 o'clock, again 2 centimeters, 4 centimeters, 12 o'clock, 6 centimeters. Let's say that's accumulative. So what is called as mass curve of rainfall. Then height of graph. So it's a very, very important. Please note that what is height of graph. The relation showing the intensity of rainfall versus time is called height of graph. Very, very important between GATE examination point of view. Height of graph and hydrograph. Don't confuse that. Height of means intensity of rainfall versus time. Hydro, discharge versus time. This is very, very important. So height of graph is a plot of intensity of rainfall against time interval. Then depth area duration. This also curve, plot of rainfall depth against area for a particular time interval. So, for example, first question is discussed. one side graph plot of intensive rainfall versus time. Let us say, for example, today 4 hours. First hour 2 cm/h. Second hour 1 cm/h. Third hour 8 cm/h. Fourth hour like that. The graph showing the relation between the intensive rainfall versus time, that we call as a hydrograph. Then depth area duration DAD dot. So plot of rainfall depth. Let's say against area. Against area, this see, don't confuse. Against air mass curve of rainfall is the accumulated precipitation against time. Hydrograph is intensive rainfall against time. DAD curve, plot of rainfall depth against area, right? For a particular time interval. Then intensity duration frequency IDF. This one, plot of rainfall intensity against time interval for particular frequency. Say it's a particular area, particular frequency. What is frequency actually? Let's say, for example, rainfall 10 centimeters of depth, right? It's occurred in once in 100 years. For example, Tirupati city recorded rainfall of 10 centimeter rainfall once in 10 years, like that. So what is called as frequency? That is called frequency of rainfall. So into the IDF curves, then depth to duration frequency, DDF, plot of rainfall depth against time interval for a particular frequency. So these 3-5 are also very, very important bits, one mark gate questions. They can ask any type, but one is asking from the these among these 5. One, every gate examination, depth area DDF or IDF or DAD or hydrograph or mass curve interval. One asking from this simple topic, the presentation of rainfall data. Then you know, next, mean precipitation means average rainfall. So how you need to calculate the average rainfall over any area actually? If you know the average rainfall, for example today maybe maximum, after 1 month there is no rainfall. Now, like that, if you know the average rainfall, you are supposed to plan it, you are supposed to estimate the even structures as well as in crop details. So that's why average rainfall is required to calculate. So there is a 3 methods to calculate the average rainfall or mean rainfall. One is arithmetic mean method. You know that number of stations, p bar equal to p1 plus p2 plus so on by n. It is a simple arithmetic mean. Then Thiessen polygon method. So this Thiessen polygon method is p bar equal to p1 a1 plus p2 a2 plus and so on pn an by a1 plus a2 by an. So this it is called as this also very important. A1 by a. Let us say this by seeing this formula, a1 by a, right? A2 by A, because of A1 plus A2 is what is actually total area. Let's say it's a total area. A1 plus A2 plus up to AN. If we sum it, you are supposed to get total area. Now you separate it A1 by A, A2 by A, like that. A3 by A, like that. So AN by A are called Thiessen weights. So these are called as Thiessen weights. Now, isohyetal method. What's isohyet? It's a line joining the points of equal rainfall. So once you see, that's a very important note down. First of all, isopluvial order already discussed now actually here. This is called isopluvial, means lines of connecting equal depth of rainfall. It's called isopluvial. Here, it's isopluvial lines. Now, it is one more important. Isohyte. What is isohyte? Line joining points of equal rainfall, right? It's called isohyet. Line joining the points of equal rainfall is called isohyet. So what's the isohyet method? So let's say A1 into P1 plus P2 by 2 plus A2 into P2 plus P3 by 3 plus like that by A1 plus the total area. What is it? P1 P2 is called annual precipitations recorded 1, 2 and rain gauge stations respectively. This A1 A2 is called the area of rain gauge stations. So among 3 methods, which will give accurate method actually? So one is arithmetic average method, second one is Thiessen polygon method, third one is isohyetal method. So this arithmetic average method gives only rough average. Coming to the Thiessen polygon, it gives somewhat better results than arithmetic. Isohyetal method gives accurate results when compared to other 2 methods. Then, frequency analysis, what I already told you, know what is frequency is, for example, the flood, the quantity of flood. Let us say, for example, if you talk in engineering subjects, you talk about flood. When particular flood means, for example, the quantity of flood, for example, 20 centimeter rainfall, heavy rainfall occurred in only 1 day or only 1 hour, this rainfall might have been seen in before 100 years once. So for example, that quantity of flood or the magnitude of flood occurred in once in 100 years. What is called as recurring interval or frequency? That's that we mentioned here. So the time interval between occurring of an event, event means here flood, let us for example, the time interval between occurring of an event of certain magnitude, let's say, correlated to event means rainfall, certain magnitude means, let's say for example, 100 centimeter. Example for that, that's all. This is heavy flood, 100 centimeters, heavy flood. Let's say for example, occurring an event, let's say rainfall or flood, magnitude, let's say 100 centimeter, which is like to be equal or exceeded is called frequency. So already I told you, know. So for example, today 10 centimeters rainfall occurred. So this type of rainfall, which is likely equal or exceeded before that, before maybe 100 years or 10 years or 20 years, right? What is called as frequency or return period or recurrence interval. It's important, it's denoted by term T. So different formula gives T recurrence interval, T equal to n plus 1 by m. Pagan's formula, T equal to n by m minus 0.5. California flora, T equal to n by m. What is m? Rank of required data, n equal to total number of data. Rank means, for example, 10 centimeter, 100 centimeter, 20 like that. So which more more value, more rank, that's all. That's the rank. Now we come into the evaporation. So you know there's a natural process. So evaporation from water bodies and the soil masses together with the transpiration from vegetation is known as evapotranspiration. So evaporation and transpiration. Evaporation means evaporation from the, of course, water bodies or land, whatever it is. Transpiration means evaporation from the leaves. It's called transpiration. So if you together evaporation from water bodies and soil masses together with the transpiration from vegetation is known as evapotranspiration. So what is evaporometer? To estimate the evaporation, evaporometers are used. So what are the types of evaporators? Class A evaporation tank. This is important for your university examination also. Sometimes asking, write about the class A evaporation briefly. 4 months of famous question. So ISF standard pan. So what is this actually? Lake evaporation equal to Cp into pan evaporation, where Cp equal to pan coefficient. What is this actually? For example, if you want to know about the lake evaporation, let us say, for example, in our tank, Venkatapuram tank, which is situated besides our college, we want to calculate how much evaporation from that tank. So that's assumed as it's a lake. That lake evaporation equal to Cp means pan coefficient. Where it is, what is pan actually? So sometimes, say, let us say, for example, or you calculate directly evaporation from a Venkatapuram tank, you know, you can see the evaporation, but how to calculate? What is the measurement of that? It is very difficult to put an instrument for that lake. So what is the alternative you are supposed to set up in a evaporation pan in our college. You are supposed to take measurement of evaporation in our college itself. Same is applied to the Venkatapuram tank. That's why it's called Cp, means that coefficient, that may be 0.6, 0.2 like that, into pan evaporation. It's your lake evaporation. And transpiration. So transpiration is the process by which water leaves the body of a living plant and reaches atmosphere as water vapor. So this is called transpiration. So see, once again, it's one more. Isopleth. So isopluvial lines, then isohite, isopleth. They're already third term. So only one question is asking in the gate also, this one, this type of questions. The line joining the equal rainfall, line joining the equal rainfall depth. This also, the lines on a map through places having equal depth of transpiration are called isopleth. Right? In general, plant transpires 80% more than required. Next. This is the transpiration ratio equal to weight of water transpired on plant during its entire life by weight of dry matter plant after wilting. Then there is a PET and AET. What is PET? Potential evapotranspiration. So the evapotranspiration measured. What is meant by evapotranspiration? Evaporation and transpiration. So the evapotranspiration measured when the ground is having adequate amount of moisture to fulfill the vegetative needs of the crop is called potential evapotranspiration. Once again, the evaporation measured when the ground is having adequate amount of moisture to fulfill the vegetative needs of the crop. Then what is actual evaporation? AET. The evapotranspiration measured at a particular place at a particular time. So the ratio of AET to PET is always less than or equal to 1. Next. How to measure evaporation? Using lysimeter, right? The lysimeter is used to measure the evapotranspiration. This is important bit. So these are various methods to calculate the potential evaporation. Lanick-Riddle method, that's Kp into Tm by 100. So PET equal to daily potential evapotranspiration in inches per month, right? K equal to consumptive use factor. See, consumptive use by tank cooperation. Consumptive is Cu. So of course, what is meant by consumptive use, we'll discuss later. So Tm equal to mean monthly temperature in Fahrenheit. Then Penman's equation is also there to calculate the potential evapotranspiration. A into Hn plus A into gamma by A plus Y. So this also asked in your UNOS examination once. So PET equal to daily potential evapotranspiration in millimeter per day. A equal to slope of saturation vapor pressure, Vs, temperature curve. Hn equal to net radiation in millimeter of evaporable water per day. A equal to parameters of wind velocity and saturation deficit. There is a gamma equal to psychometric constant. Next. So what are the probability studies? So what is probability actually? The magnitude of event. Event means here in our civil engineering point of view, flood. The magnitude of event that was occurred in a once in 100 years or once in 10 years, once in number of years like that. That's called probability studies. What is the use of probability studies actually? Ultimately, you are supposed to design structures. We know the probability studies. Let's say, for example, what it is. If the probability of event occurring is P, let's say, for example, P is the probability of event. So the probability of event not occurring, Q equal to 1 minus P, not occurring in any year, 1 minus P. So let's say the probability of occurrence of the event R times in x-axis of S, P or N, this is a binomial distribution. Let's say the probability of event, let's say event means here rainfall, not occurring in any year, because this type of rainfall may not occur in any year during last 100 years or 200 years or 1000 years. If the probability of event occurring in P is P, probability of event not occurring in any year, Q equal to 1 minus P, let's say, for example. Now, the probability of occurrence of the event R times, let's say two times, in the n successive year, let's say 50 years. So the magnitude of flood may occur in two times in 50 years, like that is the meaning. So how to determine the probability of R times n successive years equal to NCR P power R into Q power N minus R. What is Q? 1 minus P. What is P? 1 by T, because the probability of event occurring in P. So now, the probability of event, the probability of the event not occurring at all in n successive years. So R equal to 0 here. Let's say P0n equal to N C0, P power 0, Q power N minus 0. So the final you are supposed to write Q power N. The probability of event occurring at least once in n successive years. At least once. What is actually 1 minus Q power N. What is Q? 1 minus P. 1 minus 1 minus whole power N. That will be calculated about the probability. So probable maximum precipitation, PMP. So it is defined as the greatest or extreme rainfall for a given duration that is physically possible over a station or a basin. That's called probable maximum precipitation, PMP. So that the formula P bar plus K into sigma, where K equal to precipitation factor, P bar equal to mean precipitation, sigma equal to standard deviation. Now, infiltration. So there is a, what is the three important phases in hydrologic cycle actually? Evaporation, right? Then precipitation, runoff. So precipitation is form of, you know, the precipitation is rainfall, how to measure the rainfall, how to measure the average rainfall, that come under the rainfall data. Then evaporation, what is evaporation, what phase evaporation is calculated. Then runoff, before runoff, you are supposed to know about the infiltration. What is infiltration? The maximum rate at which a given soil at a given time can absorb water is defined as the infiltration capacity of that soil. Infiltration is the soil capacity, not water capacity. Let's assume that because of the soil having the capacity to hold the water, capacity to absorb water is called infiltration. So already I told you the definition between the seepage, percolation and infiltration. What is meant by seepage? The movement of water. Percolation, movement of water. Infiltration, movement of water. All three are movement of water, but the small difference is there. So seepage means the movement of water in any direction is called seepage. The movement of water from medium to medium is called infiltration. So the movement, the vertical movement of water from any media is called percolation. That's what is called as deep percolation. Now, let us see. So the maximum rate at which given soil at a given time can absorb water is defined as the infiltration capacity. So when F equal to FP, when intensity of rainfall I is greater than I equal to FE. how it is actually I equal to incident of rainfall. When incident of rainfall is greater than right filtration, what happens actually? For example, 2 cm rainfall is there according to the for a given soil. Infiltration is greater than 2 cm. What it is actually? So it may not. So the whatever the water as a form of rainwater almost all absorbed to the land. Now F equal to I when I is less than FV. That's see difference. So I equal to intensity of rainfall. F equal to actual rate of infiltration. Now infiltrometers. So to know the infiltration capacity, infiltrometers are used. There is two types: single ring infiltrometer. Second one is double ring infiltrometer. So what is meant FC? So FC means infiltration or constant infiltration. FC equal to volume of water in ring by surface area of ring divided by duration of infiltration. So rainfall simulator also used to calculate or to determine the infiltration. I equal to P minus R, where I equal to infiltration, P equal to precipitation, R equal to runoff. So where I equal to infiltration, infiltration equal to total rainfall minus total runoff. That's all infiltration direct formula. Hawthorne's equation, FP, infiltration at any point, P equal to FC, it's called constant infiltration, FC, plus F0 minus FC means F0 equal to infiltration. It's also important in your university examination. F0 minus FC into e power minus kh into t. The power values of 0 is greater than or equal to t, less than or equal to tc. This is a very, very important formula. FP equal to FC plus F0 minus FC into e power minus kh into t. What is FP? Infiltration capacity at any time t is called FP. F not equal to initial infiltration capacity at t equal to 0. Fc equal to final steady state infiltration capacity occurring at tc. Kh equal to R Hawthorne's decay coefficient. So that's given t equal to time in hours. So this is one of the very, very important actually pi index. What is pi index actually? The pi index is the average rainfall above which the rainfall volume is equal to the runoff volume. So this is the pi index. The pi index is the index above which this portion rainfall volume equal to the runoff volume. So if you draw a graph between the rainfall intensity versus time, what is this graph is called? Hydrograph. Hydrograph is a relation showing the intensity of rainfall versus time. So for example, first hour, second hour, third hour, fourth hour, fifth hour. First hour maybe 2 cm per hour, second hour let's say 5-7, again decrease. So this one, for example, 4 cm per hour is the pi index. What is the pi index? Above which rainfall volume equal to runoff volume. Then W index, W equal to P minus R minus IA by TE. So for initial losses is taken into consideration. That's the difference between pi index and W index. So what is P? Total storm precipitation. So what P is the total rainfall, R equal to total runoff, IA equal to initial losses, TE equal to duration of rainfall excess. What is rainfall excess actually? This one, duration of rainfall excess. For example, this 2 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour. This is 1 hour not rainfall excess. This 1 hour may be taken as rainfall excess. Like this, this is TE, duration of rainfall excess. So for uniform intensity of rainfall, pi index equal to double index. Let's say there is no initial losses, the pi index equal to double index. So for non-uniform intensity of rainfall, pi index is greater than double index always. Now stream flow measurements. So when your stream is flowing, how to measure the stream flow? So that's called area velocity method, dilution technique, ultrasonic method, indirect methods, hydraulic structures, slope area method. Of course, this topic is now you are studying in 4.2, 4.1, 2, second chapter. So stream flow measurements, area velocity method. That's area velocity method. Directly you can calculate discharge using area multiplied by velocity, and dilution technique, ultrasonic method, indirect method, hydraulic structures, slope area method. So measurement of velocity by current meter. So what is this actually? V.2 plus V.8 by 2. What is V.2 means? Velocity at depth 0.2. V.8 means velocity at depth 0.8. This is average 0.2 plus 0.8. It will give average velocity. So V.2 means 20% depth of velocity. V.0 means 80% of depth velocity. V.0 is the average velocity of a stream. Like that. This is a dilution technique. Q is equal to Q2 into C1 minus C2 by C2 minus C0. Where Qt C1 let's say plus Qs into C0 equal to Qs plus Qt into from above equation. So that where Qs equal to discharge of stream. And what is meant by Qt? Discharge of traces. C1 equal to test rate concentration at section 1, C2 equal to test rate concentration at section 2, C0 equal to background concentration. So this is the formula. Then one of the important cycle in hydraulic, important phase in hydraulic cycle, it's called runoff. So what is meant by runoff? The draining or flowing of precipitation from a catchment area to a surface channel is called runoff. So precipitation, infiltration, then runoff. So the drainage, the draining or flowing of precipitation from a catchment area. What is meant by catchment area? The area which is drained into the system is called catchment. So the draining or flowing of precipitation from a catchment area through a surface channel is called runoff. The part of the runoff which enters the stream immediately after the rainfall is called direct runoff. So runoff is two types: direct, indirect runoff, or surface runoff, subsurface runoff, then groundwater flow. These three types. Runoff may be divided as three types: surface, subsurface, groundwater flow. So the part of the runoff which enters the stream immediately after the rainfall is called direct runoff. The delayed flow that reaches the stream essentially as groundwater flow is called base flow. Let's say surface runoff, base flow. The base flow is like this. So when the ground delivers water into the stream or receiver water from a ground is called effluent stream. So when ground delivers water into stream or stream receives water from ground is called effluent stream. When stream delivers water into ground is called influent stream. Receives water from stream is called influent stream. There is difference between the influent stream and effluent stream. These are the points to be known before solving the problems. So let us see, for example, this problem. The plan area of reservoir is 1 square kilometer. Because of the area of reservoir is like that, the water level in reservoir is observed to decline by 20 centimeter in a certain period. Let's say, for example, today the water level may be 50 centimeters. Let's tomorrow is declined by 20 centimeter in a certain period. Let's say for one day. During this period, the reservoir receives a surface inflow of 10 hectometer. Say during this period, because of that whatever the depth decline, in between there is a chance of inflow from a rainfall or some other stream, whatever it is, you don't know. So during this period, the reservoir receives a surface inflow of 10 hectometer and 20 hectometers are subtracted from the reservoir for irrigation and power. So the pan evaporation and rainfall recorded during the same period at a nearby meteorological station, or say, let's say for example, nearby meteorological station. Let us say for example, this example may be compared with our Venkatapuram tank. Let's say for example, Venkatapuram tank is area 1 square kilometer. So depth decline by 20 centimeters, whatever the period may be. So during this period, surface inflow received into the tank 10 hectometer. So let's say 10 hectometers means 10 into 10 power 4 into meter square into meter, right? 10 into 10 power 4 cubic meter. And 20 hectometers means 20 into 10 power 4 meter cubic meter. Or subtracted from the reservoir for irrigation power. The pan evaporation rainfall recorded during the same period at a nearby meteorological station, let's say for example in our college, 12 centimeter and 3 centimeter respectively. Rainfall is 3 centimeter, pan evaporation is 12 centimeter. So the calibrated pan factor is 0.7 because of pan coefficient. So the seepage was from the reservoir during this period in centimeter is. So we are supposed to calculate seepage from the particular time. So let us say for example here, so inflow of water means, let us say 10. Hectometer, 10 number cubic meter. Outflow means 20 hectometers are subtracted from the reservoir for irrigation. It's outflow, it's inflow. So, but how much rainfall in 3 centimeters? Then, if you know the depth of rainfall, you are supposed to calculate volume of rainfall. Volume means area into depth. How much area? 1 into 10 power 6 square kilometer into 3 centimeter by 100 meter. Thus, it will give 3 into 10 power 4 cubic meter. Then, how much evaporation actually? Let us say pan coefficient is 0.7. Pan evaporation is 12 centimeters. So 0.7 into 12. That's called 8 power. That's called what is called as pan coefficient. Before also I told you. And volume of evaporation, how much evaporation actually? 8.4 centimeter. That centimeter is converted into meter, 8.4 into 100. Into area, entire area, 1 into 10 power 6 into area. So that will give total volume of evaporation, 8.4 into 10 power 4 cubic meter. So now net decrease volume equal to this much. So, volume of evaporation, right? This much of volume is evaporated. Now, volume of rainfall this much. right? So no net decrease event, well, how much actually 10 means 10 centimeters decline, 10 centimeters is already this mentioned like this, see here, this, right? Minus 20, right? Because of water inflow and outflow, 10 minus because of inflow of water 10, outflow is my inflow is plus, outflow is minus, that's all. Plus again 3 centimeters inflow adding. So minus 8.4 again outflow, evaporation is like that out into 10 power 4. This give minus 10. So in terms of depth, but don't bother minus 10 because of minus 10 indicates that minus 10 indicates that there is out of outflow, that's all. So in terms of depth, minus 15.4 10 power 4 by total area. It will give 0.1 square meters, 515.4 centimeters. So observed decrease of level equal to 20 centimeters. So then if you detect seepage, total is 20 centimeters, down decrease in volume terms of depth 15.4 centimeters, that will give 4.6 centimeters the seepage losses. For example, seepage loss are calculated like this. For example, say it's important problem given in every GATE examination. So the normal annual rainfall at station A, B and C situated in meteorologically homogeneous regions of 175 centimeters, 180 centimeters and 150 centimeters respectively. So in year 2000, let's say the station B was inoperative. Let's say missing data, already discussed, no? How to find out the missing rainfall data. So station B was inoperative and station A and C are recorded annual precipitations of 150 centimeters and 135 centimeters respectively. So the annual rainfall at station B in that area would be estimated as how much? So let's say there are two methods, arithmetic average method and normal deviation method. So when the deviation is within 10%, it can be used as a direct average method. When deviation is more than this, we will go for the normal deviation method. So now you see, let's say ABC values here that, but normal annual precipitation at station B is missing. But how much normal annual station B actually, the annual rainfall at station B in that area could be estimated, right? So what is A, annual precipitation 150 centimeter? What is going to be 135 centimeter? So here, this formula, precipitation at B, right? How much actually precipitation at B? So precipitation at B by normal annual precipitation at B, P by NB, right? Equal to two station, or made to PA by NB plus PC by NC. This you can calculate directly, you can give precipitation at B equal to 158 centimeter. That's like this, you have to calculate, right? Let us say, for example, the probability of centimeter rain in 1 hour occurring at station B found to be 1 by 60 because of gauge problem variable. The probability of centimeter rain in 1 hour occurring at station B is found to be 1 by 60 because of that once in 60 years, like that, for example, like that. So what is the probability that 1 hour rain of magnitude 10 centimeter or larger, 10 centimeter above, will occur in station B once in 30 successive years is the binomial distribution, PCR equal to P, R means one time 30 years. Let's say, for example, once in 30 successive years, PR means 1, 30 equal to 30, NCR 30 C1 into P, 1 by T, 1 by 60, right, into NCR Q power N, because 59 by 60, 1 minus P by N, 1 minus P, 1 minus 1 by 60 whole power N minus 1, right? That's for 29. That will give you 0.001. Let us say, it's important. During 6 hour storm, the rainfall intensity was 0.8 centimeter per hour, right? During 6 hour storm, because there is a storm occurred in 6 hours. What is storm actually? Set off, because the rain is continuing 6 hours. There is 6 hour storm. Rain is continuing in one week storm, 1 month storm, like that. So for example, during a 6 hour storm, the rainfall intensity was 0.8 centimeter per hour and the catchment of area 8.6 square kilometer. So the measured runoff volume during this period was 2,56,000 cubic meter. The total rainfall was lost due to infiltration, evaporation and transpiration in centimeter per hour is dash. So let's see step by step. Volume of water means area into depth. What is the area? 8.6 into 10 power 6, right? Here my 8.6 square kilometer, 8.6 in pounds square meter into 0.8 centimeter per hour. So 0.8 by 100 converted into meters. How many hours? 6 hours. So this one. So what is the runoff volume? This one. What is the loss of water? Runoff minus total rainfall. So let's say, for example, total volume of water minus runoff. How much? This much. Now, this is the total volume. So the total volume by area, it will give us depth. Again, depth is distributed for 6 hours. If you divide by 6, it's per hour is 0.304 centimeter per hour. So the answer is like this, right? B. So this is a grouping. So it's also get examination also. So stream flow velocity. So we are measured the velocity in stream flow means velocity meters is used, right? So evapotranspiration rate is the mass method, infiltration rate, Horton's equation, right? Current meter used to measure the actually S is P equal stream flow velocity, P equal evapotranspiration rate, R equal infiltration rate. S wind velocity, right? 1 anemometer, 2 Penman's method, 3 Horton's method, 4 current meter. So current meter used to measure which one? Steam flow velocity. Horton's method used to calculate infiltration rate. Evapotranspiration rate used to measure Penman's. So almost again, obviously wind velocity is measured by anemometer. So the answer is C. So the rainfall during 3 successive 2-hour period is 0.5, 2.8 and 1.6 centimeters. The surface runoff resulting from this storm is 3.2 centimeter. The pi index of storm is dash. So how to calculate actually? Let's say total rainfall in 6 hours means, let's say 2 hours period in between 0.5 plus 2.8 plus 1.6. So it will come around 4.9 centimeter. What is going to surface runoff? 3.2 centimeter. So what is your pi index? What is going to this 0.5 centimeter? So let us say the pi index is 0.5 centimeter. Oh, how much calculated here actually? 1.2 centimeter per hour, right? So the rainfall during 3 successive 2 hours period is much. The surface runoff resulting from this storm is 3.2 centimeters. The pi index of the storm is dash n. So the pi index of surface runoff 3.2 equal to what is going to pi index actually? The pi index is index above which rainfall is equal to runoff value. So that's why I first calculate total rainfall this much. What is going to the surface total surface runoff 3.2 centimeter, right? So the pi index is above 0.5 centimeter. Let's say for example the pi index is above 0.5 centimeters. Only 2.8 to 1.6. So 1.6 minus pi, right? Into 2 like this. So that pi is calculated as 0.6 by 2. It will be around 0.3 centimeter per hour. So at a station, storm one of 5 hour duration with intensity 2 centimeter per hour. Let's say storm one, duration 5 hours, intensity is 2 centimeter per hour. So resulted in runoff of 4 centimeter. So you have to prepare table column in examinations. So storm one, storm two. Below storm one, duration 5 hours, intensity 2 centimeter per hour, runoff R equal to 4 centimeter. And storm two is 8 hours, runoff 8.4 centimeter. Pi index is the same for both storms. The pi index is the same for both storms. How to calculate? So now total rainfall due to storm 1, how much? 2 centimeter per hour into 5 hours, 10 centimeter. So runoff how much actually? 4 centimeter. So total rainfall minus runoff by time, it may use 1.2 centimeter. The answer is B. So it is in Horton's infiltration equation. Just you have discussed it in Horton's infiltration equation Ft or F equal to Fc plus F naught minus Fc into e power minus kh into t. So during a 3 hour storm event, it was observed that all obstructions other than infiltration are negligible. Rainfall was idealized as 3 hour storms of intensity 10 mm per hour, 20 mm per hour, and 10 millimeter per hour respectively. And the infiltration was idealized as Horton's curve, F equal to 6.8. The equation already directly given. F equal to 6.8 plus 8.7 e power minus t. So F is in millimeter per hour and t is in hour. What is the effective rainfall? Let us say step by step. Infiltration rate at t equal to 0 is 15.5 centimeter millimeter per hour. Infiltration at any time t equal to 1 is 10 millimeter per hour. So effective rainfall starts after 1 hour only. So what is my total rainfall? 20 plus 10, 30 mm. So infiltration equal to between 1 to 3 hours. So 0 to 3 limits. So if you apply this equation, then integration, finally it reduces to 16.37. Now the effective rainfall is total rainfall 30 minus 16.67, 13.6 mm. So already we know lysimeter is used as instrument to measure the evapotranspiration. This is very important bit. Evapotranspiration is measured by using lysimeter. So now here, so average velocity. You are supposed to calculate point V0.2, V0.8/2. It's called average velocity. So now the top this problem come under the discharge in a stream. So the top width and the depth of flow in a triangular channel are measured as 4 meter and 1 meter respectively. The measured velocity on center 0.2 meters or 0.8 meters below the surface are like this. So using 2-point method of velocity measurement, discharge meter per second is channel. 2-point method means already we discussed. The average velocity V bar equal to V0.2 plus V0.8/2. So how much V0.2? 0.7, 0.6. Then V0.8, 0.4. Let us say, so that's 0.6 plus 0.4/2 is 0.5. So what is my area? Half BH. So what is my discharge? A into velocity. That's all. Let us say this simple problem. A catchment area 200 hectares means 200 into 10 power 4 meters square has a runoff coefficient is 0.5. A storm of duration larger than the time of concentration of the catchment and intensity 3.6 centimeter per hour and causes a peak discharge meter per second is dash. See, 0.5 is a coefficient, that's why multiplied by 0.5 into 200 hectares, 210 power square meters into intensity 3.6 millimeter per hour. So it's a time means by 60 into 60. It's a per hour, per minute, per second, 60 into by 60. This centimeter converted into meter. So finally it may be around 10 meters per second. Last. So you know network density, a catchment area has a 7 rain gauge stations, optimal number of rain gauge stations, n equal to Cv by epsilon whole square, where Cv equal to coefficient of variation, sigma by p bar into 100, right, sigma equal to standard deviation, sigma I equal to 1 to m, sigma minus sigma 1 minus sigma bar whole square, like that. So a catchment area has 7 rain gauge stations. In a year, the annual rainfall recorded by the gauges are as follows, 130, 142, 118, like this. So 5% error in the estimation of mean error, that's epsilon equal to 5%. Calculate the number of additional stations required to be established in the catchment. So first of all, you are supposed to mean rainfall p bar equal to 130.4 given, right? Standard is sigma by p bar. Sigma is calculated like this: sigma I minus sigma p bar whole square, like that, right? So Cv equal to sigma by p bar in 100, it will be 17.28. So optimum number of rain gauge n equal to Cv by epsilon. Cv equal to 17.28. Epsilon in 5% allowable error, that will be 12. So already 7 rain gauge stations are there. So total is 12 rain gauge stations required. Already 7 is there. Additional rain gauge stations 5 is required. Okay. Last problem: rainfall intensity of 20 meter per hour occurred over a watershed area of 100 hectares for a duration of 6 hours. So measured direct runoff value in the stream draining the watershed was found to be 30,000 millicubic meter. The precipitation not available to run off in this case. Read the problem very well. Rainfall equal to how much? 20 millimeter per hour. So 20 by 1000 meter into how many 6 hours duration into 100. What is 100 hectares? 100 into 10 power 4. It's around 120,000 cubic meter. What is the runoff? 30,000 cubic meter. Now what is the infiltration? Total rainfall minus total runoff, 90,000 cubic meter. This depth of infiltration means total infiltration divided by area, it will give 9 centimeters. So this is how preparation of gates. I will share the material also. So next gate class is on Monday. 4:30 that I will give link. Of course, same link actually. Once again, I will give message also to you. So thank you, friends. Thank you for listening. Great class also. And also, I request to remaining people also to please motivate and listen the classes. It will help you to your your 3-2 exams also very much. Okay, right.